Honeybees, they'll sting you for no reason at all. They're nasty. I mean, they're important, but they're nasty. Okay. That's my take on the whole thing.
Until just now, I kind of thought everyone loved honeybees. We've been managing their hives for more than 4,000 years. They play a huge role in our food system by pollinating many of our favorite crops, and of course, they make honey. But Mark Wagoner is a third-generation alfalfa seed farmer in Washington's Walla Walla Valley, which might be the one place on Earth where honeybees aren't welcome with open arms because, well, they found a better bee. I'm Shane Campbell-Staton, and this is Human Footprint.
Agriculture in the Walla Walla Valley is unique in that we don't have any water in the summertime. And so people like my grandfather, my father, and the neighbors around here figured out they could grow alfalfa.
More specifically, Mark produces alfalfa seed, which other farmers use to grow alfalfa hay, which is fed to livestock like dairy cows. Alfalfa originated in the Middle East, but Mark's grandfather observed wild bees visiting his alfalfa crop here in Washington.
And then in the 1950s, an entomologist from Washington State University named Herman Amenke came down here and figured out that these alkali bees were pollinating the alfalfa.
And alkali bees, a local native species very different from honeybees, turned out to be kind of extraordinary pollinators. Alfalfa can produce 200 million flowers per acre. And pollinating them is actually kind of tricky.
If I can do this right, I can push down on that. It's called the keel, then the stamen pops out.
Oh.
Yeah, see that?
Yeah.
Alfalfa flowers have spring-loaded sexy parts. When a bee trips the keel petal, the stamens snap upward and release the pollen.
Supposedly that hits the honeybees and they don't like it.
Okay.
Because I told you they're nasty.
Honeybees avoid getting pollen slapped by sidestepping the keel petal, taking nectar without pollinating the flower. That's why Mark isn't too fond of honeybees, and he's not alone.
Well, we actually have a county ordinance that we passed that limits the number of honeybees people can put here. It keeps them out of here to protect our native bees.
Honeybees came to North America with European colonists. They aren't native here. Neither are the alfalfa leafcutter bees commonly used to pollinate this crop elsewhere in the U.S. They evolved with alfalfa in the Middle East. Yet here in Washington, the local alkali bees are the best alfalfa pollinators of all. These bees are tough, or possibly just dumb. They'll get smacked in the face and keep right on going. And the alkali bees' short adult lives line up perfectly with the alfalfa bloom. A single female can visit 5,000 flowers and collect 4 million pollen grains a day. But farming with alkali bees takes more than just keeping honeybees out.
This is my dad and I in like 1964 on one of the first artificial bee beds he built.
That's amazing.
Bee beds are patches of soil that farmers maintain for the solitary ground nesting alkali bees. These bees won't just nest anywhere. They look for just the right level of soil moisture, delivered here through a network of buried pipes.
When we start up, I probably spend 4 hours a day trying to get the water going.
Oh, wow.
Like the first couple weeks, it just drives me insane.
And water is only part of the formula.
Then we put salt, NaCl. We get it in 2,500-pound bags from Salt Lake City. So we put it in a little fertilizer spreader and spread it on the bee bed in April.
The salt forms a crust and keeps the soil from drying out. And punching thousands of tiny holes in the soil, like little starter homes, helps convince the bees to move in. The farmers are literally transforming the ground under their feet to make space for alkali bees. When everything's just right, you can get up to 100 nests per square foot. Mark's 18 bee beds cover about 30 acres of his farm, and they're worth every acre.
If you have 1,000 acres of seed and you get 400 pounds more per acre by having alkali bees, at $2.50 a pound, that's $1 million bucks.
$1 million bees.
And yet, for all their benefits, these native bees have mostly flown under the radar for the last 70 years.
I bet you there's people that live around here that probably don't even know the relationship exists.
That's Doug Walsh. He's the state entomologist for wine grapes. Not a bad gig for a bug guy. But he also works with local alfalfa growers, so he knows how special the alkali bees are.
Is this something that's widely done around the country?
Nope. It's done really right within a 8-mile circle of here, with us at the center of the circle.
Turns out this little valley is the only place on Earth where farmers manage wild, ground-nesting bees for commercial pollination. And with the alkali bees' help, they grow a quarter of the U.S. alfalfa seed crop. So the growers really take care of their bees, even adopting strict speed limits near bee beds. In 2012, the state wanted to build a new highway through the valley.
In fact, the highway went right over one of the bee beds.
A 2024 study estimated that in the western U.S. alone, tens of millions of bees are killed by vehicles every day. So the growers needed to know, would the alkali bees fly over the new highway, or would the fast-moving traffic be a problem? The State Department of Transportation asked Doug to find out.
I guess my first question is, what the hell is this thing?
This is what I call a vehicular bee sweeper.
This Mad Max contraption has just one job, motoring down country roads, gathering bees in its 14 nets. Doug and his students counted the bees in each net and crunched the numbers.
Just look at the nets and see that it proved that all the bees are hugging the ground.
Yeah,
especially on a windy day like today.
So the new highway would put the low-flying bees at risk.
We did actually get the Department of Transportation to move the entire freeway over a couple of hundred yards and over a hill. So I take credit for a bend in the road.
Okay.
But alkali bees face a bigger problem than roads because they share the fields with alfalfa pests. Pesticides can be lethal to bees, but ignoring the pests isn't an option. They can easily destroy an entire crop. So working with Doug, the growers have come up with ways to fight pests without harming the bees.
None of them will spray insecticides during the day.
The growers only spray once the bees are done foraging for the day and the chemicals are dry by the morning.
Hence the alkali and bees are not exposed.
But this scenario is unique. Alfalfa seed is by far the most important crop here, so everyone's invested in alkali bees.
People have tried bringing these bees to other alfalfa growing areas like California, but the bees haven't been able to thrive there.
I really do think it probably is a product of insecticide exposure of the bees in these other growing areas that have a greater diversity of crops.
In areas with more diverse crops and greater pesticide use, alfalfa seed growers are stuck using leafcutter bees, typically buying new bees every year.
But these things, that you can't move them, and you can't buy them. I mean, you have to raise them like kids. Mm-hmm. These things are like children, and they don't move away. And so you're sharing these bees. They're like the closest thing to communism that we have around here. Because those things just go everywhere.
Okay.
They're like our friends, yeah. They're just friends.
Other native bees, about 4,000 species of them in the U.S. alone, face the same existential threats that alkali bees do. It's just that with all eyes on honeybees, we're not paying as much attention to all the others. So this could be a good time to diversify our pollinator portfolio and show our native bees some love. Thanks for watching. If you want more Human Footprint, you can tune into the full-length series on the PBS app or on your local PBS station. Check out the link in the description to find out more about the show. So this could be a good time to diversinate. Yeah. So this could be a good time to diversinate. Wow. Why?